So, welcome guys. Today in this lecture, I'll be explaining few very basic concept regarding structural audit. What is structural audit? Why do we need to conduct structural audit? And how do we conduct structural audit? So let's proceed into the lecture, and we'll be talking about, as we proceed further, we'll be talking more and more about structural audit. So next. So in today's lecture, this lecture is for the purpose of creating awareness amongst the civil engineers, the residents and owners of buildings towards the health examination of existing concrete buildings. So here this structural audit is basically like a doctor patient relationship, where the structural engineer is a doctor and the patient is your existing structure. So the periodical structural auditing and diagnosis for health of existing building is the most important for finding the present serviceability and structural viability of your structures. So in order to conduct the diagnosis for the health of existing building, we need to conduct structural audit. Now let's talk about the definition of structural audit. Structural audit is an overall health and performance checkup of a building, like a doctor examines a patient. As I've told earlier, this whole process is like a doctor patient relationship, where your structural engineer is a doctor and the patient is your existing structures. So basically, structural audit ensures that the building and its premises are safe and have no risk. It also analyzes and suggests appropriate repairs and retrofitting methods, which is required for the building to perform better in its service life. So the structural audit helps us to analyze and suggest appropriate methods of repairs and retrofitting. And the most important part in this structural audit method is this structural audit is carried by an experienced and licensed structural consultant. So now let's talk about the need or the purpose of structural audit. So why do we exactly need to perform to conduct a structural audit? So the first and the foremost, the very important aspect of structural audit is it is conducted to save the human life and save the life of buildings. Since these buildings are made for human occupancy, so the major aspect to conduct structural audit is to save human life. Then this structural audit is carried out to understand the exact condition of the building, like how the building is performing, how the building has deteriorated since the start of that building, like with respect to time, what is the present condition of that building. Next is this structural audit help us to find critical areas which requires repair immediately. And then next is to comply with statutory requirements, that like your local municipal corporation, they might be having certain statutory requirements. So in order to comply with those requirements, structural audit needs to be carried out. The next important point is structural audit is required to enhance life cycle of building by suggesting preventive and corrective methods. So by structural audit, we are provided with preventive measures as well as corrective measures. Next is measures or methods like repairs and retrofitting, whether your structure needs to be repaired or it needs to be retrofitted. So these are the main basic purpose of structural audit. We can say it as the need of structural audit. Next is this point suggests that there are certain strict rules under bylaws, building bylaws, where as per clause number 77 of revised bylaws of cooperative housing society says that the society shall cause the structural audit of a building as follows. So for building aging between 15 to 30 years, once in a 5 years. So structural audit should be conducted once in a 5 years if your building ages 15. So between 15 to 30 years, you need to conduct a structural audit every 5 years. Next, for building aging above 30 years, we need to conduct structural audit every 3 years. So these two conditions need to be kept in mind, that how frequently we need to conduct structural audit. Now let's move to stages in carrying out structural audit. So there are basically 4 to 5 stages in structural audit. The first stage is the study of architectural and structural drawings, design criteria, design calculation, structural stability certificate of existing structure. So in the first step, the structural engineer needs to inspect all those existing documents, the architectural drawing, the architectural design, structural drawings and designs, everything which the existing building has. The next method, the next step, the next stage in structural audit is, if those preliminary those documents are not present, then the structural drawings, then as built drawings can be prepared by an engineer. So the engineer need to be to prepare an as-built drawing of the existing structure. Next, the next stage is to conduct visual inspection. After visual inspection, the NDT and destructive tests are being carried out. So in the next slide, we'll be talking about the different visual inspection stages. So first of all, we need to see why do we need visual inspection. So the first condition is, we need visual inspection to recognize the types of structural defect. So exactly which type of structural defect has occurred in the existing building. Next is to identify any sign of material deterioration. So by visual inspection, we can easily make out if any material deterioration has been taken place in the existing building. Next is to identify any signs of structural distress and deformation. So if any structural distress and any deformation of any member is has been occurred, then we can easily identify by visual inspection. The next is next point is to identify any alteration and addition in the structure misuse which may result in overloading. So in this condition, there is, if there is alteration in the existing structure, if there is addition in the existing structure, or there is any misuse, that can be inspected visually. So these points are taken care while conducting visual inspection. So let's talk about the scope of visual inspection. The inspection report should reveal the following listings along with photographs and sketches. So while conducting visual inspection, please take care that every single photograph should be taken care. Every single aspect of that building should be covered. So the first points in scope of visual inspection is general information. First of all, we need to have these general information of the building, like the name and address of the building, number of stories in each block, description and main usage, like occupancy type. If you have a residential building, then you should mention it is a residential, commercial or institutional. Next, maintenance history of the building. So if in history, if past there is any maintenance work carried out, then we need to list down those maintenance, and we need to also list down the frequency of those maintenance. Now the next part of visual inspection, where we need to take care of the, we need to identify the structural system of the building. So the structural system, basically the structure consists of substructure, superstructures. So the substructure, we can just through visual inspection, we can just look into the settlements of columns, found if there is any settlement of column, foundation, is there any deflection or cracks in retaining wall, the soil bearing of the soil bearing capacity through trial pits or from adjacent soil data. We can just find out the soil bearing capacity either of the existing soil data, or we can just take a few trial. The superstructures, the material used and framing system of the superstructure, like which materials they have used in the building, and what is the framing pattern of the building. So identification of the critical structural members like floating columns, if they have any, so if they have any floating columns, there is, if there is a transfer beam, any slender member, rusting exposed steel, if there is a exposed steel reinforcement, and how much it has been exposed, how much it has been rusted. So these structural system of the buildings can be visually inspected. Also mention the status of all building elements like beams, slabs, columns, all this canopy, false ceiling, chajja, parapet and railing with respect to parameters, deflection. So all these components of the structure should be inspected with respect to parameters, with respect to deflections. We can say if there is deflection, visible deflection, cracks, leakages and spalling of concrete. Likewise, verify the status of water tank, staircase, lift and machine room. So if they have any water tank, staircase, lift and lift machine room, these are very important part of a building. We need to carry a very thorough visual inspection of these components like water tank, staircase, lift and lift machine room. Please check whether there is a leakage in the water tank. Next is addition or alteration. If there is any addition or alteration in the building, then we need to identify the change of occupancy, addition or alteration of partition wall, if any partition wall is added, loading stacking, alteration of addition, toilets, water tank, if any extra toilets or water tank has been added or altered, if any additional balcony is provided or any alteration in the balcony. So these are the part of your visual inspection. Now let's talk about that. If there is any dampness on and leakages, like detect the dampness, if there is a dampness in wall, identify the leakages in terrace, toilets, plumbing lines, drainage line and overhead tank. So these are the points which we need to keep in mind while conducting the visual inspection. So now we'll be talking about non-destructive and destructive testing. So in addition to the visual inspection, the real strength and quality of concrete structure need to be checked with non-destructive tests or destructive tests. A number of non-destructive tests NDT for concrete members are available to determine present strength and quality of the concrete. So in order to determine the present strength of the concrete, we need to carry these tests, these non-destructive tests or destructive tests. Some of these tests are very useful in assessment of damage to RCC structures subjected to corrosion, chemical attack, fire and due to other reasons. These tests have been put under four categories depending on the purpose of the test as under. So these are four categories I have listed in the next slides. So let's get into those four categories and we'll explain that. So the first category is concrete strength. So in order to find the concrete strength, we have these three tests, rebound hammer test, which is required to measure the surface hardness of a concrete. The next is ultrasonic pulse velocity test, which is required to assess the homogeneity of concrete, to assess strength of concrete qualitatively, and also to determine the structural integrity. Next is your core sampling and testing. So by that core sampling method, we can measure the strength, the permeability and density of concrete. The next type of test is the chemical attacks. So next type of test conducted in order to identify the chemical attack on your reinforcement. So these three tests are basically conducted to identify the chemical attack on your structure, your reinforcement, your RCC. The first test is carbonation test, which is required to identify, to assess depth of carbonation and pH of concrete. The next is to assess the total water, acid, soluble chloride contents. The next is similar to your chloride test, in which this test is for sulfate. So to assess total water and water soluble sulfate contents of concrete. This corrosion potential assessment is basically for your reinforcement. So in order to confirm the concrete cover, the corrosion of embedded steel, the permeability in the concrete, these three tests are conducted. So cover meter, A cover meter test is conducted to measure cover of reinforcement, the diameter of reinforcement, and so the cover meter test is conducted to measure the cover of reinforcement, a dia of reinforcement, and spacing of reinforcement. Then comes your half cell method. The half cell method is basically conducted to identify the probable corrosion in the embedded steel, the probable corrosion in your reinforcement. Permeability test is carried out in order to assess permeability of concrete due to water and air. So this was the corrosion potential assessment. Now comes the homogeneity and integrity. This already we have discussed, this ultrasonic pulse velocity for determination of cracks and discontinuity. We have discussed in the compressive strength, the strength of concretes. To identify the homogeneity, if there is any honeycombing in your RCC members or not. So in order to identify the homogeneity and integrity of the structure, we need to carry ultrasonic pulse velocity. This core testing method, this core testing method is basically to identify the exact compressive strength of the member, and also to inspect visually how much the structure, the component, structural component, has been deteriorated. So this is a direct method of assessing strength of concrete. In this method, a cylindrical core sample are taken from existing structures. The cores are visually inspected and tested in laboratory to check its compressive strength. Next is your pushover analysis. So this analysis is a bit different from your NDT and TT. Generally, pushover analysis is used to understand the existing capacity of structure for seismic and gravity loading, which will show different occupancy levels like immediate occupancy, life safety, and collapse prevention. So the seismic evaluation in this method, the seismic evaluation of existing building compares their capacity against earthquake demand at specific site and concern the potential earthquake caused risks to building system and elements that are closely related to human life safety. So this analysis is basically conducted, this is a software based analysis where the occupancy levels like immediate occupancy, life safety, and collapse prevention, these are fixed in this pushover analysis. So next is identification of critical areas in building. So based on the above inspection analysis and test results, the report should conclude the critical areas that need immediate repairs and retrofitting. So for example, number of columns requiring immediate repair and strengthening repair of critical slab and beams, waterproofing of terrace, toilet blocks, cracks in walls or structural elements. So this is after identification, after conducting the structural audit, the critical areas of buildings are listed down, and the repair methodology as per those critical area that are suggested. Now comes about post structural audit. Now after structural audit comes the repair and retrofitting. So the first is your repair. So based on the audit findings and recommendation, different measures of repairs and strengthening are carried out according to ACI 546R04. To repair is to replace or correct deteriorated, damaged or faulty materials, components or elements of a structural system. So from this point of view, repair may be divided into structural repair and serviceability repair. So the former, that is the structural repair, refers to the restoration of lost sectional or monolithic properties of damaged members, while the latter, that is your serviceability repair, refers to the restoration of structural surfaces to a satisfactory operational standard. So now strengthening and retrofitting. So strengthening is the process of restoring the capacity of damaged components. Like we are restoring, re-strengthening the damaged component of structural concrete to its original design capacity for which it has been designed. So we are strengthening to its original design capacity, or increasing the strength. We may also increase the strength of the structural concrete. So strengthening of a concrete structure may be required due to several reasons. First is change of usage, which may cause overstress in the structural member. Then serious materials and structural deterioration, which cause structural members to be no longer able to carry the imposed load with an adequate factor of safety. and also to increase the capacity for seismic resistance if the building is not designed for it or the structure does not fulfill current design requirement. This last point, to increase the capacity for seismic resistance, is very important. If your structure, the existing structure in past have been not designed for seismic load, so then we need to strengthen it to fulfill the current design requirement corresponding to seismic zone response reduction factor and all the seismic criteria if that structure has not been designed for seismic load, or if the seismic zone of that area is revised and it has been designed previously, it has been designed for some other seismic zone. So in that case, we need to strengthen that design. So strengthening of structural member can achieved by replacing poor quality or defective material with better quality material, by attaching additional load bearing material such as high quality concrete, additional steel, thin steel plates, various types of fiber reinforced polymer sheets and so on, and by redistribution of load such as by adding a steel supporting system. The purpose of strengthening is to increase the load carrying capacity or stability of structure with respect to its previous condition. So the main purpose of strengthening is to increase the load carrying capacity or stability of the structure with respect to its previous condition. So finally, after discussing so much about the structural audit, we have come to a conclusion where the structural. So this the conclusion suggests the structural diagnosis is very vast, important and highly responsible job which is connected with the lives of human beings. The major conclusion after conducting the structural audit of this lecture is that we have to save human lives which are occupying those buildings. So structural audit is conducted to save the lives of human beings which are occupying those buildings. It is also mandatory and advisable to carry out the periodical structural audit of the buildings by professional experts, as I've suggested, experienced licensed structural engineer or consultant, and act immediately through recommendation provided in audit report. The success of repairs and restoration is always based on thorough knowledge, correct diagnosis and in-depth studies of problems in building, proper repair practices and finally socio-economic conditions. The effective implementation of auditing enhances the lifespan of structure, prevents deterioration of the building, leading to sustainability. So this was regarding your structural audit. This was a very basic lecture regarding structural audits. We can also come up with different structural audit techniques, with different structural audit tests. So hope you have understood this lecture. If you have any query, you can come up with your doubts. We can try to clarify your doubts. We will come up with few more videos if you suggest us to come up with those videos. So till then, have a nice day. Take care. Goodbye. Thank you.